Good morning, everyone. Merry Christmas. For unto us a child is born, and unto us a son is given, and his name shall be called Emmanuel, God with us. Can we rejoice in that fact that came true over 2,000 years ago today? Would you please stand with us and let's sing of his first coming as we rejoice in hymns together, the first Noel. Let's continue with Joy to the World, number 270, if you love to read in the words and the parts in the hymnal. One, two, one, two.
Repeat the sounding joy.
God praise and thanks this morning. Take a moment, greet those who are around you, try to find some guests and visitors and welcome them.
Every long awaited, precious promise, Son of God and Son of Man. Heaven's glory in a manger has come to us in Bethlehem. Messiah, a baby born to save us all. Messiah, on our knees we fall.
All we love for,
Father, we come before you this morning in this place of worship to say thank you. Thank you for the gift of Jesus, Emmanuel, God with us. Lord, your word is very clear. A light will come into the darkness, this great light. And for unto us, a son is born, unto us, a Savior is given. So, Father, for all those in this room right now who know who Jesus Christ is personally, we say thank you again for choosing us, for opening our eyes and opening our ears and softening our hearts to the need we have. But, Father, we also ask in the name of Jesus Christ that for anybody here and listening here who has yet to say yes to Jesus, may today be that day where an eternity is redirected. Father, may everything in this hour bring you glory as we celebrate the greatest gift of all, Jesus Christ. We pray this in his name. And the church said,
Amen.
Merry Christmas, everybody.
Merry Christmas.
Grace, mercy, and peace to every one of you. In the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Spirit. Amen. You may be seated.
And as you are seated, I'm going to invite Trista and Charlotte and Kylie to come forward at this time. On this Christmas Eve, they are here to approach the baby who was born for the forgiveness of our sins, the sins of those who would so believe in their hearts and confess with their mouths that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God above. The most important question you will ever be asked, and therefore the most important question you can ever give an answer to: do you receive on this Christmas Eve the gift who is Jesus Christ? Do you receive Jesus as your Savior? Do you receive Jesus as your Lord? Kylie, do you? Charlotte, do you? Trista, do you? And all God's people say, amen. And do you trust Jesus and only Jesus? Because he tells us that he is the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father. No one is redeemed except through Jesus Christ alone. Kylie, is it just Jesus? Charlotte, only Jesus? Trista, just Jesus? Amen. Do you love God's word along with us? Do you believe by the power of the Holy Spirit, it's inspired, infallible, inerrant? It teaches us all that we need to know about Jesus and our need for salvation through him. It shows us and tells us the best way to live our lives, a way that brings glory to our God in heaven. Kylie, do you so love God's word? Charlotte, do you? Trista, do you? It's everything you believe on the inside. It's what the Holy Spirit has convinced you of in your hearts. It's what he's convinced you of in your minds. So now what are you going to do with that? Will you live as faithful disciples? Will you live as faithful followers of Jesus? Will you let the light of your life, obviously different, shine in this world, sharing Christ one relationship at a time in how you speak, in how you give an answer, in how you interact, in how you bless others? Will you seek to be such a faithful follower of Jesus? Kylie, will you? And Charlotte, will you? And Trista, will you?
Yes.
Amen. Let's pray together. Father, on this Christmas Eve, thank you for the incredible gift. Thank you for faith, the opportunity to approach Jesus, found in a manger, living a perfect life that we could not, walking all the way to the cross to take our place, suffering and dying, shedding his blood, that we might believe and be forgiven, lives redeemed for here and now, and lives redeemed for all of eternity. Thank you for the gift given, and now the gift received. We praise you. And we pray it all in Jesus' name. Amen. Church, would you praise God for his faithfulness in their lives? And Pastor Earl and Cal is serving as our elder this morning, a certificate for each of these young ladies to remember God's promise to them and the promise and the yes that they have shared with him in response. Please continue to encourage these three and all of those who you have heard say yes to Jesus in the past. Thank you, church.
Three daughters of their church. Which means for those of you that are members of this church, thank you for doing your part and being active in that covenant of baptism. Thank you for being there, for praying and encouraging not only these three, but those that have gone before, as well as those that are coming behind them as they walk in individually as Jesus Christ as a personal Lord and Savior. Just a quick reminder, we do have cookies and some refreshments in between the services, okay? This is the tricker, though. If you have cookies waiting for you at home, you only get one, okay? And if you don't have cookies, you can have two, all right? But please, enjoy them. They're made for you. There's hot cocoa, there's coffee, there's water for you if you prefer that. Let's go to God in prayer, shall we? Heavenly Father, we come before you again. We celebrate what you are doing in the life of your people. And Father, for these three young ladies that came before this church today and said, individually, I accept Jesus Christ. I accept that he is Emmanuel and he is the way, the truth, and the life. Lord, that is the most important decision these three girls will ever make. And for us that were a part of that, whether that's a parent, a grandparent, a sibling, if that's a friend, if that's a Sunday school leader, if that is a member of this church that has just been faithfully praying for your Holy Spirit to intervene in their lives, God, thank you. Thank you for the promises that you have for those amazing, amazing young women. And Father, this is the eve of the day where we celebrate, where we remember the greatest gift of all, and that is Jesus Christ. As Isaiah says, that your light will come into the darkness, and no doubt, Father, it did. 2,000 years ago, it's a dark world. It's a scary place. And often difficult to pursue you as Lord. And Lord, we know that today is relatively dark as well. But your light is still shining ever so brightly. So for those in this room who have the light of Jesus, who are living in the Spirit, may we be a reflection of that light. May we bring the forgiveness, may we bring the love, may we bring the grace and the mercy that we all have when we are in the Spirit. Because Father, if we're all honest, we're going to gather with family, gather with friends, and sometimes all those relationships aren't that great. But we have the ability and we have the opportunity to make the decision. Will we reflect you? Will we love the stranger? Will we love those around us? Will we forgive those around us? And Father, also many of us are going to be gathering around a table and enjoying a meal. And most certainly that loved one that we miss so terribly will not be there. Maybe it's because you've already called that individual home, or maybe perhaps that individual is serving to protect our freedom on some foreign land. Lord, for that open chair, for those that remember, for those that mourn, comfort them. Give them peace. Remind them that you are there and dining at the table as well. And Father, for the opportunity we have in this world to gather together under the name of Jesus Christ, we say thank you for the freedoms we have. We say thank you for the opportunities we have to open up your word, which unapologetically is the only truth this world has ever known. And Father, we get to open it today and read a relatively familiar story. But Lord, I pray that you open the eyes and open the ears and open the hearts of all of the listeners, that they may see this story in a new light, that they may recount the depth of your love for them. And thank you for Pastor Sean, who is going to teach us. Thank you for his wisdom, his insight. And Father, we say thank you for what you're going to do. As in just 1 week from now, we walk into a brand new year. Your blessings, we ask for them. Your mercies, they're new every morning. And your forgiveness, abundant. Thanks for loving us, Father, and we pray this in Jesus' name. And the church said, amen. Amen. I want to invite the children to come forward for a children's message. As they're doing so, just a couple of reminders. The big one is today is tomorrow is Jesus' birthday. May everything that we do revolve around that, whether we're giving the gifts, whether we're serving the food. I want to encourage you, parents and grandparents, will you pull out Luke 2? Will you read that? And will you share the greatest gift to those who are in your family room or around your dining table? Next Sunday, December 31, catch this, friends. There's one service, and it's 9:30. Okay? One service next week, Sunday, 9:30. Can you tell me what time it is? 9:30. Next Sunday. Awesome. Thank you very much.
And if you are a guest this morning, make sure you take a look. There's a welcome card in the pew right there. And you can share as much information about yourself. Maybe you're looking for a place to worship and make much of God. If you would fill that out and share it with us at the information desk following our time together this morning, that'd be wonderful. Boys and girls, do you know what to do on the count of three? Nice and loud. Are you ready? One, two, three.
Good morning.
Hey, what do I have here? I need you to turn around. Look at me. Look at me up here. Can you all see? What is this?
A box.
It's a box. Is it kind of dark and dreary?
No.
Does it look fun?
Yeah.
Does it look kind of sparkly?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a present. I have a present. Somebody gave me a present. Do you like presents?
Yeah.
Yeah. Do you think you should just leave the present closed? What should I do with my present?
Open it.
I should open it?
Yes.
Oh, I'm so excited. Let me open my present. Oh, look at that. What are those? Yes, somebody gave me a present. Look at that. And it is all mine. I want to tell you a story. There were some shepherds. And shepherds watch their sheep. And they were out in the fields. They were watching their sheep. And all of a sudden, the sky above them lit up in the middle of the night. And it was filled with this choir of God's angels. And they were singing. And they told them that someone had been born. Do you know who was born that night?
Jesus
was born. And so the shepherds, they ran into town and they followed the star and they found the place where Jesus had been born and they saw him and they praised God. And then later on, they took off to go back, but they kept right on singing and they were sharing. Say that with me. They were sharing with other people what they had seen, who they had seen. They were sharing with other people who had been born. Do you think that was a good idea that they shared and that they told other people about Jesus?
Yeah.
I think that's a good idea too. And so this morning, we're going to light the fourth candle of Advent. It reminds us that we have all been given a gift. We've actually been given the gift of Jesus. And it's really good to have that gift and to believe in that gift for ourselves. But it is very important to share that gift, to share the name of Jesus with others. And so we're going to fold our hands, bow our heads, and pray. And then after that, I'm going to share my gift with you to help you remember how important it is to share Jesus with others. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the gift of Jesus. We thank you for the best gift ever given. Help every single one of us to receive Jesus, to love Jesus, to believe that he's our Savior and our Lord. But help us also to share his name with others, to sing about him, that they also will believe. And we pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. Boys and girls, I'm going to come down here and I'm going to give you a Tootsie Roll. And once you have your Tootsie Roll, you may go to children and worship or you may go back to your seats.
Thank you.
We turn to the Christmas story on this Christmas Eve, Luke chapter 1 and Luke chapter 2. Luke chapter 1 and Luke chapter 2. You'll find a pew Bible located right there in front of you. If you do not have a copy of God's Word, that is His gift for you. Do not leave here without that most important of all books, the only saving truth this world has ever known. Luke chapters 1 and 2, God's gift for us on this Christmas Eve. Let's pray together. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we indeed continue to praise you. We continue to thank you for who you are, for what you have done, for who we are in Christ, and for the opportunity that we have to make much of him, to share him, to shine as representatives of his light in the midst of this darkness, that you would use even those of us who are gathered here to bring in the harvest of those who you so love. Show us again this morning what you would have us to do for you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The expression "Happy Holidays" is personally frustrating. Maybe you feel the same way. I don't like it when people say "Happy Holidays." It seems to fall flat. It seems to fall short. For me, it misses the point of Christmas entirely. But maybe that's why some people say it. Maybe they say it on purpose. Happy holidays. Maybe they want to miss. They want to avoid. They're trying to dismiss Christmas altogether. They're trying to hide behind a curtain this idea of a loving God. They're trying to hide the idea or the picture of a baby who was born and placed in a manger. They're trying to hide this idea of one who was born into this world to ultimately redeem the lives of those who so believe, providing for the forgiveness of our sins. Maybe that's why some people say happy holidays. Because the idea of Christmas seems too fantastic. It seems too fictitious. Maybe it just seems impossible. Impossible. Throughout this season of Advent, we've considered things that sound impossible. The impossible moments around the gift that God would provide. There was an old man with his wife who was advanced in years, remember? They'd never had any children. And yet, having celebrated all these birthdays all these years, God blessed them with the gift of a son. It seemed impossible. God made it possible. There was a king, a worldly king, who heard of the newborn king. He hated the idea that someone would take any of his own power, any of his own kingdom. He refused to relinquish control. And yet, what seemed like an impossible stepping aside from power, God made possible. Herod ultimately lost it all. And then there was Joseph. He was wrestling through everything in his mind. He was trying to reason it through, trying to understand, what do I do now? Considering how all of this is going to unfold, it doesn't make any sense. It doesn't look good. People are going to say things. And it seemed like an impossible moment. And yet, in the midst of the perceived impossibility, God made it all possible. What about maybe the most impossible idea? A young Mary. A young Mary, she's engaged. She's a virgin. And yet she's going to give birth to a son? Are you serious? How is that going to happen? Did God really do that? And if God did do that, what did it mean for Mary? And if God did do that, what does it mean for any of us here on Christmas Eve? Step into the Christmas story with me, Luke chapter 1, beginning at verse 26. Listen as God makes the seemingly impossible possible. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. And the virgin's name was Mary. And he came to her and said, "Greetings, O favored one, the Lord is with you." But she was greatly troubled at the saying and tried to discern what sort of greeting this might be. And the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall call his name," what church? "Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give to him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever. And his kingdom, of his kingdom, there will be no end." And Mary said to the angel, "How will this be, since I'm a virgin?" And the angel answered her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be called Holy, the Son of God." God takes what looks and seems and sounds impossible, and he makes it possible. And in the midst of that, how does Mary respond? And because of this, what has our response been to this good news of great joy? Well, first of all, for Mary, number one, what does she do? How does she respond? Number one, she makes a confession. Say that with me. She makes a confession. Now, this whole story is so familiar. You've heard it since you were one of these little children sitting up front here on the steps. The whole story of Christmas, the whole story of the Nativity sounds so familiar. We often just skip over it. We know what is taking place. But because it's familiar, don't miss the details and don't miss the reality of what is taking place here, the emotion of the moment. Mary is barely a young woman, or she's an old girl. She's probably 13 or 14 years old at best. And her 13 or 14-year-old life is interrupted by an angel, and not just any angel, it's the angel Gabriel, who is sent by God. God had been silent for 400 years, and now the angel Gabriel is breaking that silence, personally visiting and interacting with Mary. And he's explaining to her what's going to happen. He's explaining to her that by the power of the Holy Spirit, she is going to become pregnant. And not only is she going to become pregnant, but she is going to be used by God to give birth to Jesus, the Son of God. He's going to be given the kingdom of God, and of his kingdom there will be no end. How does a 13 or a 14-year-old girl respond to that angelic news and announcement? In the echo of that seemingly impossible news, how does Mary respond? Again, a confession. She makes a confession in that moment, even a confession of faith. Look at verse 38. Mary said, "Behold, I am the what? I'm the servant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your what? Word." I'm God's servant. And God, whatever your word is, written or spoken, let it be to me, let it be applied to my life. The baby to be born, his name is to be Jesus. Jesus means that God is salvation. He's going to be the Son of God, the Son of the Most High, born by the power of the Holy Spirit. What does Mary do in this moment? She believes it. She trusts the angel. She believes it. She trusts it. She confesses her faith and she declares, "I am your servant. I'm your bondservant." In that moment, she relinquishes the control of her life. Imagine Kylie and Charlotte and Trista standing up here this morning and hearing this good news of God. It doesn't always make sense. It's difficult to understand it in its entirety in the midst of that singular moment. And yet Mary confesses her faith and Mary believes and she surrenders her life entirely to it all. God, as you have said through this angel, so let it be. I'm your servant. As your word describes, as your word declares, may it so be in my life. Is that true for us? You know, we exist in a world and in a culture that says you have to know what's going to happen next. You have to have answers to the questions. You need to question everything. You need to avoid believing any one thing. The culture and the world around us says, don't be quick to jump into everything. You need to be sure. And if you think you are, you still have to have some form of an escape plan. You still have to have a way out. What about us? What about you? When you hear the good news of Christmas, when you hear the name of Jesus, when you hear of the one who's going to be born for the forgiveness of sins, do you trust it? Do you believe it? And do you confess your faith in him? Or does it all seem too impossible, too fictitious, maybe even too fantastic? Mary believes and she confesses her faith in Christ. And then scripture tells us that she takes off running. Mary takes off in a hurry. She's making her way to the hill country. Scripture says she's heading towards the area of Judah. And in Judah, she is specifically looking for her relative who goes by the name of Elizabeth. What's her name? Elizabeth. And when she finds her way to Elizabeth, Elizabeth has also become pregnant. God has blessed Elizabeth with this pregnancy. And as Mary arrives at her home, Elizabeth offers over Mary, number two, a confirmation. Say that with me, a confirmation. Look down at verse 41 with me in Luke chapter 1. Verse 41. And when Elizabeth heard the greeting of Mary, the baby leaped in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. And she exclaimed with a loud cry, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb. And why is this granted to me that the mother of my Lord should come to me? For behold, when the sound of your greeting came to my ears, the baby in my womb leaped for joy. And blessed is she who believed that there would be a fulfillment of what was spoken to her from the Lord." Church, read verse 45 with me. Let's read together. And we read saying, "And blessed is she who believed that there would be a fulfillment of what was spoken to her from the Lord." This is beautiful. This is crucial. Elizabeth does not miss this opportunity. She hears of Mary's confession. She hears of how Mary is surrendering herself to God, of how she's trusting in God's word and in God's purpose and in God's plan. And Elizabeth confirms it. Elizabeth encourages her. Elizabeth blesses her. Blessed is she who believed that there would be a fulfillment of what was spoken to her from the Lord. This is a beautiful moment. Elizabeth could have just listened to the situation and nodded her head in response. And yet here is Elizabeth, advanced in years. She's old. And here is this young girl, this young woman, Mary. And from Elizabeth's place, She encourages, she testifies, she shares her story, she affirms, she calls out Mary, she confirms Mary's confession of faith. That Mary would continue to be faithful, that Mary would continue to walk faithfully before the Lord. What about us? What about us? Do we do that? Do we do that as the body of Christ? Do we do that as a church? I mean, Trista and Charlotte and Kylie standing here this morning. Scripture tells us that even the angels in glory rejoice. Even the angels in glory confirm the confession of faith that takes place here. But what about us? What do we do? Looking back at 2023, there were 46 individuals who stood before the Lord. There were 46 individuals who stood before us this past year. And they confessed their faith in Jesus as Savior and Lord. Amen, church? Amen. To the glory of God in heaven. But did it end there? Was it just something that we watched? Was it just something that we listened to and then quickly moved on with life? Or did we approach that young woman? Did we approach that young man? Did we approach those older individuals? Did we confirm? Did we encourage? Did we bless? Did we testify? Did we share our own story? Did we challenge them to continue on in the faith? Did we invite them to ask us questions? Church, are we missing an opportunity that's really a blessing for us? Mary confessed her faith before God, and her relative Elizabeth confirmed it all and encouraged her. Who could you speak confirmation over today? Who could you encourage? Who needs to hear your testimony? Who do you need to share your journey with Jesus with? Anybody come to mind? Having been blessed and encouraged, having heard this word of confirmation spoken over her, what does Mary do? Number three, she breaks out into celebration. Say it with me like you believe it, into celebration. Hang on to that celebration and bring it down. And dare to be honest with me. Life has not been easy this past year. Maybe it's been easy for some people, and they seem to stick out. But life for you has not been easy. It's had its challenges. It's had its dark moments. You thought maybe there were some opportunities. You thought maybe there were some solutions. You thought maybe some things were going to change. You kind of thought there might be a victory, but then all of those things were dead ends. All of those things fell short. All of those doors seemingly were slammed in your face. There is no change. There doesn't appear to be any answer in the near future. Hasn't been an easy year. Mary would be able to agree with you. Mary's life wasn't necessarily any easier. We read of her in Scripture, and it appears that she has it all together. That's why God chose her. Mary's life was not easy. Mary grew up in a town that didn't even deserve a dot or a speck or a location on the map. As is mentioned in Scripture, does anything good come out of Nazareth? Mary's life wasn't easy. Mary's life was hard. Mary's life was work and the same work every single day. She was a part of the people of God, and yet God had been silent for 400 years. What do you do when your God is silent for 400 years? What do you do when your God doesn't speak to you? Jewish in her faith and yet under Roman occupation. And the Romans were continuing to ramp up their militaristic endeavors. They were taking over everything. They were exacting high taxes from everybody. They were putting the pressure on. There was seemingly no way out. They were the people of God, and yet God was quiet, and the world was bringing tremendous force against them. You see, Mary's life wasn't easy either. Until Gabriel. Until sent by God, Gabriel made his announcement. And in that seemingly impossible moment, she confesses her faith. It's confirmed by Elizabeth. And now Mary's mind comes to life as she is given this tremendous hindsight. Say it with me, hindsight. And this is what launches her Magnificat. This is what launches her celebration. All of a sudden, regardless of the current situation, regardless of the circumstances of this past year, regardless of the dark struggles and despair and depression and doubt, regardless of all of that, Mary looks back and she sees the faithfulness of God. Say that with me. She sees the faithfulness of God. She sees the faithfulness of God in this moment. She says, you know what? I could be focused right here, right now on today. I could sit right here in the darkness of the moment of today, in the struggle and the darkness and the moment of today. I could just focus on me, myself, and I, and what is not going right. I could do that. Or I could look and see and identify and recognize that my God has been faithful. And so my God is going to always be faithful. Amen, church? And you see what follows in Scripture, beginning in Luke chapter 1 at verse 46, all the way through verse 55, this is Mary's celebration. This is Mary's song. What does she do? She looks backward, and she begins to quote Scripture. The references in her song speak to the book of Genesis, speak to the book of Deuteronomy, speak to 1 Samuel, speak to countless Psalms. It even references the book of Job and what we hear in the book of Daniel. She looks back and she names it all and she sees the faithfulness of God, and this brings celebration upon her lips. How many times are we not able to celebrate? Or how many times do we decide not to celebrate because it's a bad day? Bad days tend to come in a string or a cluster. Bad days can become weeks, and of course, weeks become months. But you already know that math personally. Sometimes that keeps our mouths closed. We don't feel like celebrating. And yet, church, there's definitely a need to celebrate, because our God has been faithful, and our God will always be faithful. And we can believe that even today, our God is faithful. Amen, church? So how would that affect our celebration? How would that affect our praise? Our God is bigger than what we're going through right now. And ultimately, He has already provided for the forgiveness of our sins and glorious life everlasting. Can we say amen, church? It might seem impossible to move beyond what you're going through right now, but you see, God has already moved in your life, and the victory is already yours. Mary makes this confession. Elizabeth beautifully encourages and confirms it. Mary breaks out into a song of celebration. She sees how God has been faithful even when he seemed quiet for so long. But there's one more thing that we need to see in this moment regarding Mary, and that is number four, her contemplation. Say that with me, her contemplation. Of everything that's taken place, we fast forward to Luke chapter 2, and the baby has been born. His name is Jesus. He is the Christ. He is the Son of the living God. And on that night, the shepherds were out in their field, keeping watch and tending to the flocks under their care. And having seen the angelic, and having been shocked by the angelic choir, having listened to what was shared, they raced into town and made their way to Mary and Joseph, interrupting the couple of the newborn child. And the shepherds said this in Luke 2, verse 11. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior who is Christ the Lord. Join me in reading that, church. Here we go. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior who is Christ the Lord. A Savior. The Christ. The Messiah. Lord. For unto you, for you, born for you, a Savior. The story goes on to tell us in verse 19, Mary treasured. Having listened to what the shepherds told her, Mary treasured up all these things, pondering them in her heart. On that first celebration of Christmas, holding her newborn son, the one and only Son of God, Mary contemplated. She contemplated a Savior, Messiah, Lord, born and given for the forgiveness of sins. There would come a point in time when she would have to turn him over, sharing him with a world. There came a point in time when she would have to watch as he was placed upon a cross. There came a point in time when she heard him cry out in agony. And yet there came a point in time when she saw him rise again. Amen, church? On this Christmas Eve, can we contemplate and can we ponder what God would do through us in the new year ahead? What would it look like if we share? What would it look like if we tell? What would it look like if we go? What would it look like if we share the love of God that is found in Jesus Christ, one relationship at a time? What might next Christmas bring? It's not impossible. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, may it be so. Help us not only to believe for ourselves, help us not only to receive for ourselves the gift of Jesus as Savior and Lord, But help us now in contemplation, in consideration. Help us now in commitment to make much of him in our lives, to always be willing to share with any who will listen the name and the answer, who is Jesus Christ alone. For we pray it in his strong, saving name. Amen. Church, if you're able to stand, would you please do so? It is the gift of Christmas that we celebrate together. And yet it's a gift that's far too good to keep just for ourselves. And it's a gift that deserves to be celebrated, not simply one evening or one day a year, but every day of our lives, because that's exactly what we will do. We will celebrate for all of eternity. So let's share the name and the life and the gift of Jesus with all who we meet. And as you do so, know this: you are loved by your Father in heaven. You are filled with the unstoppable power of his Holy Spirit. And Jesus is the only one who's forgiven you of all your sins. Merry Christmas, church. Let's sing together.
This is our God, living and breathing. is our God, living and breathing. Call him courageous, relentless, and brave. This is our God, loving and reaching, scandalous mercy and mighty to save. Hallelujah, this is our God. Hallelujah, this is our God.
bless you. Have a wonderful Christmas. Go in his peace.